I'd like to talk today about cancer, how we develop novel therapies for cancer, and my research on acute myeloid leukemia. Despite public perception, cancer is not a modern disease. In fact, some of the earliest discovered human tissues in archaeological sites are riddled with tumors. And some of the first confirmed medical notes are from an ancient Egyptian physician discussing cancer, under which he wrote, "There is no cure. As long as humans have been alive, we have died of cancer. As long as we have died of cancer, we have tried to treat cancer. But until the invention of chemotherapies in the 1950s, we have not had any effective treatments for cancer. Even now, cancer results in between 4 and 5% of all deaths worldwide. Overall, effectively treating cancer is the single greatest objective in biomedical research. It has the greatest propensity to increase longevity, prosperity, and quality of life. On the small scale, I know my family has been affected by cancer, and I'm sure many of yours, if not most of yours, have been affected or will be affected as well. Despite the ubiquity with which cancer affects us all, the public remains generally uninformed about what cancer is and how we treat it. But before we can really get into cancer, we have to understand a little bit about how normal cells operate. So normal cells have an incredibly large number of proteins that they use to ensure that the cells are operating in a way that is most beneficial for the tissue as a whole and not necessarily just that cell. These systems are regulated by internal and external signals that basically decide what decisions the cells make. The three major decisions cells have to make are to divide, to stay in stasis, or to undergo apoptosis, or programmed cell death. So normally your cells are forced to stay in stasis by growth suppressing signals, although occasionally it becomes necessary for your cells to divide. When this happens, or for whatever reason, the cells receive a growth promoting signal and progress to divide. When they divide, the space in which they are becomes more crowded, resulting in growth suppressing signals again being emitted instead of growth promoting signals. And as cells go through more and more replication, they accrue DNA damage. This DNA damage results in the cells no longer being viable after a certain amount of time, and they are forced to undergo apoptosis. Now, it is crucial that cells undergo apoptosis. If they don't undergo apoptosis, dangerous cells can continue to proliferate in the tissue, which is, of course, more beneficial for the cells themselves than it is for the tissue as a whole. Now we get to think about cancer. What if one of those mutations that occurred due to the DNA damage occurred instead to one of the genes making one of the proteins that is responsible for responding to apoptosis, responding to that growth suppressor, or simply preventing mutation in the first place? Well, then a cell may divide when it should have instead stayed in stasis, or even more likely, should have been taken out of the population in general. These proliferating cells outcompete the rest of the cells around them, because now instead of all the cells having the exact same genes, these cells now have a selective advantage compared to all the other cells, and begin to outcompete them, forming this early stage tumor. In this early stage tumor, the rate of mutation is incredibly high due to the mutations that continue to progress. With this high of mutation, a heterogeneous population of cells forms. This heterogeneous population of cells has a strong competition between them, which means that only some of the cells can survive. Only the cells with the greatest advantage can survive this high level of competition. With that, certain traits are very strongly selected for. Those traits are called the hallmarks of cancer. The hallmarks of cancer were originally coined in 2000 by Hanahan and Weinberg of MIT. Every cancer has these hallmarks, and they're very interesting in that they're both what allows the cancer to develop and makes the cancer so strong and outcompete the rest of the cells, but they also provide a lot of stress for the cells. A normal cell would not be able to survive any of the hallmarks of cancer. So how do cancers survive those cells? Well, they have to become incredibly reliant on a few proteins. Whenever something is incredibly reliant on just a few proteins, we can therapeutically exploit that. Unfortunately, however, we can't exploit them in one way. Each cancer cell is incredibly different from every other cancer cell. While one may be driven by this protein, another cancer may not have that protein at all, which means that each cancer is incredibly different from every other cancer. So that's why we can't really have panacea thinking or cure-all thinking. When we say to cure cancer, it's really quite ridiculous. Nobody says to cure bacteria, to cure virus. But we continue to have panacea thinking about cancer, although cancer is really a very complex set of diseases simply defined by these hallmarks and how they evolve. So now, how do we target those hallmarks? Well, I mentioned that there's these specific proteins that they're very reliant on. We're actually going to call those proteins the escape pathway addictions. Without those proteins, the cancer cell cannot continue to proliferate. If we can knock out those proteins theoretically, we can then knock out the cancer. But how do we know what proteins have what have what escape pathway addictions? Well, if we can define cancers into different groups using genomic and proteomic approaches, then we can say that these cancers will have this escape pathway addiction, these cancers will have this escape pathway addiction, such that we can ultimately target each type of cancer's escape pathway addiction, forcing them to succumb to the stresses naturally imposed on them by the hallmarks of cancer. Now, as you may know, currently mainly use chemotherapy to treat patients, which simply causes DNA damage and prevents replication of cells, but that affects every cell in the same way, which is why it's not a viable treatment for most patients. And we really do need smarter therapies targeting the hallmarks of cancer. Now, in the lab in which I work, we research acute myeloid leukemia. Acute myeloid leukemia is a particularly aggressive blood cancer that starts in the myeloid tissue of the bone marrow. As it proliferates, it outcompetes the rest of the blood-producing cells in the bone marrow and eventually produces the leukemia that we're used to, or the white blood cell cancer. That cancer then goes throughout the rest of the body, eventually causing organ failure and death, among a whole bunch of other complications. It's not nice. The overall survival for acute myeloid leukemia is just 25%, and therapy really hasn't changed at all in the past 30 to 40 years, as we still rely on traditional chemotherapies. Now, real issue with AML is elderly patient survival. As you can see by the survivorship curve here showing elderly patients with AML, and this is actually 60 or older. Often we define elderly as older than 60. But we can see that there's been almost no improvements in long-term survival of AML for these patients, and it remains nearly a death sentence for these patients because chemotherapies do not have enough selective toxicity to target only the cancer cells and not the normal cells, which is why we really need smarter therapies, especially for AML. So now, in the lab in which I work, we use special screens called RNAi screens to identify these key proteins. And two key proteins that we've identified for AML key escape pathways are WEE1 and PARP. So what PARP is responsible for, and it's very interesting, is it is responsible for the DNA damage response to single strand breaks in the DNA. So it binds to the DNA wherever there's a single strand break, and then recruits a whole bunch of other proteins that end up repairing that single strand break, such that if we inhibit PARP then using a drug such as olaparib, then the cells no longer have their ability to repair single strand breaks in the DNA, resulting in the accumulation of single strand breaks and double strand breaks. And if enough double strand breaks accumulate, the cell will be forced to undergo apoptosis, no matter what type of cell it is. Now, WEE1 is particularly interesting because it's actually downstream from BRCA2 activation. Now, BRCA2 is very interesting with PARP combined because PARP inhibition has been found to be most effective in cells where BRCA2 is already deficient. So then if we can inhibit WEE1, we actually end up promoting CDK1 and CDK2, which inhibits BRCA2. And since BRCA2 is responsible for repairing double strand breaks in the DNA, this means that the cell will be forced through the cell cycle and won't be able to repair any of its double strand breaks. So then if we combine the inhibition of WEE1 and PARP1-2, what will happen? Well, first of all, since they're both DNA damage response proteins, we're directly targeting the hallmarks of cancer. Two of the most important hallmarks of cancer are genomic instability of the cancers, which means that they have hugely high rates of DNA damage that normal cells don't at all. And they also avoid growth suppressors, which means that they can't stop the cell cycle through external signaling. So if we can inhibit both WEE1 and PARP1-2, theoretically the cells will have no escape pathways for DNA damage accumulation and resulting apoptosis. Also, they appear to be each other's escape pathways. If you inhibit WEE1 without inhibiting PARP, the cell will simply be more reliant on PARP fixing single strand breaks in the DNA. If you do the opposite, they'll be more reliant on WEE1 fixing the double strand breaks. So ultimately, I hypothesize that the combined inhibition of WEE1 and PARP may result in increase in DNA damage and result in apoptosis. So now, how do we test this? Well, first of all, we have to use combined inhibition. So we use no treatment, single dose treatment, one of the drugs at a time, and the combined inhibition to test to see if there was actually a combined effect of the two drugs. And then we use a method called flow cytometry. In flow cytometry, you dye cells with various stains that identify non-viable cells. So then the non-viable cells are stained, we can run them through tubes, and then we shine lasers at them that are the same wavelength as the dyes. And if the cells are not viable, the light will refract. If they are viable, the light will go straight through. So now we are able to calculate the number of cells that are non-viable and viable in a population with each treatment. And so then we are able to calculate for something called synergy. So normally, two drugs will both be effective at inhibiting cells at this level. We would expect for them to be combined to be at this level. That's a calculable additive effect. Now, if the effect is greater than that additive effect, we say that it's synergistic. If it's less than that, we say it's antagonistic. So what do we find? So at 72 hours, when both drugs are most effective, the combined inhibition of Wee1 and PARP results in the synergistic decrease in cell viability. And I actually found this for every cell line at every combination concentration. In fact, I was questioned the other day when I was talking about this on whether or not this is clinically relevant, since we often find synergy, but it doesn't necessarily translate into results for patients. And actually, the MLENL cell line, if you can see, in almost all of the treatments, from the initial 1 million cells plated, there were only about 100 cells or less left after the 72 hours in this treatment, suggesting that this treatment does, in fact, have clinical relevance. And so then at 72 hours, the cells were also removed from treatment and replated without drug. When they were replated without drug, the cells that were untreated continued to proliferate just fine. The cells that had just one drug actually recovered. They only had a twofold decrease in percent of untreated, which suggests that the cells that were undergoing apoptosis at the time died off, but the rest of the cells were just fine. The cells in the combination inhibition actually had a fivefold decrease as percent of untreated. Oftentimes, there are actually fewer cells left at the 144-hour mark with the withdrawal than at the 72-hour mark in the combination treatment, again, suggesting that this may, in fact, prevent AML cell recovery and, in clinic, what we call relapse. So this treatment is certainly a viable treatment for acute myeloid leukemia, although it's not clear whether or not it'll be a good treatment for other cells, so we will, of course, have to try and figure out the escape pathways of other cancers to determine whether or not this is a viable treatment for more cancers than just AML. In the future, we hope to expand this work into mice and hopefully eventually get it into clinic to treat these patients for whom AML is currently a death sentence. And now with the multitudes of studies such as this one, we are learning more about cancer in every subsequent decade than we have over the rest of human history. And while we will not be able to cure cancer, I think that with therapies such as this one, and aided by our increased understanding of the molecular mechanisms underlying cancer, we will be able to treat all types of cancer in our lifetimes. Thank you.